really appreciate this invitation. And before I really get into this, thank you very much for attending this talk, taking out time from your family in these difficult times and attending this talk. I hope that I hope that I'll be of some use to you based on my experiences in raising research grants. Okay. The brief what is given about me is relatively generous, and I would like to also highlight I generated close to 10 crores in terms of the research grants for my research work in the last period of say last 13 or 14 years. So relatively it's a new field. When I started, I struggled a lot. Over a period of time, I'm able to stabilize in this particular space. And so I thought I'll share my experiences today. Right. So if I'm not clear in certain things, if my voice is not audible, or if I, what I'm trying to say, if I'm not very clear about this, please stop me. I'll be happy to repeat that for you. And feel free to ask me questions. And I'll also give a adequate time in between the slides and between the topics to get questions. Right. So what is the agenda for the day? I will talk about why do we need research grants, who gives, why do they give, and how do you really find them, and your necessary conditions. What are the things you need to get this money from outside people, and what is the process involved in getting funds, and what are the points to ponder, whether it is really worth writing research proposals and get money, or it is okay to continue with life, whatever life we have. What are different types of research grants we have? And I'll also talk about how do you write proposals and various other things. I will showcase some samples of call for proposals. Okay. And if you look for call for proposals, there are certain samples that are available that will help us understanding, okay, how do we really write proposals? So I will try to give examples wherever it is possible. And if I'm not clear, as I told you earlier, please feel free to stop me. I'll be happy to explain again. All right. So this is the agenda for say next 90 minutes or so. The rest of the time we will keep it for discussions. All right. Now, why do we really need money? From my side, when I'm really raising research grants, I'm looking at a lot more independence. Okay. What do you mean by independence? If I want to buy an A4 sheet paper, or I want to buy a new printer, or I want to buy a new laptop, I'm not dependent on my employer. Okay. A lot of us are working in government institutions. And funds are limited. And when we are asking for an equipment or you want to buy a book of 5,000 rupees worth, your head of the department dean says, sir, what is the need for doing it? Okay, try to manage without that. Look at a pirated version of the book. There are different kinds of reasons are given. So when you have research grants in the hand, what happens? You have enormous amount of independence, autonomy in your hand. You are not dependent on anybody in terms of buying equipments, buying books, and hiring people in order to do your own work. Right, you want to go and attend a conference abroad, or you want to go and meet another researcher in some place, or somebody has given you an invitation to give a talk outside, traveling to that place. There's a lot of independence. You are not dependent on your employer for resources. That's very important. The second one is expanding horizons. Okay, whether we like it or not, after 4 or 5 years, our life becomes very routine and rudimentary. We keep on repeating a lot more stuff in our job as a faculty member. So when we end up doing the research, exploring new things, what happened? We end up expanding horizons, right? You look at new areas. Now, for example, I work on how information and communication technologies are being used by businesses and society, right? Now, there is a new option called gig economy. People talk about becoming a delivery person for Swiggy or for Flipkart. Now, if I want to understand this, what happens earlier, I was talking about how micro enterprises are using mobile phones. Now I'm getting excited by this gig economy, or how it has generated new employment opportunities, and people are expanding their economic independence using this particular new opportunities. So this expands your horizons. You are reading something new. It keeps you busy. And you also feel excited about your life. If you keep on getting this nourishment from new ideas, right? The research grants also help you in enhancing your research capabilities. Okay, what do you mean by research capabilities? In my space, if you look at it, I've been doing data collection from 300 people, 400 people. When you have research grants, you can go up to even 40,000 people, 30,000 people, you can do the data collection. Okay, you can think of different methodologies. You can experiment with this because you have that freedom to do it because the resources are available. The research grants is also useful or needed because it generates a lot more opportunities. Say, for example, success breeds more success. Okay, so when you're applying for a research grant, some of the call for applications, they will ask, do you have any prior experience in having research grants and handling them? Or when you are applying for a conference, if you have money available, you can go and attend the conference. You end up meeting other people working in similar areas. It creates a lot more opportunities. So it is more like you end up giving a lot more awards to people who already have a lot more awards. If somebody receives a Nobel Prize, already received a Nobel Prize, we call them and keep on giving them a lot more awards. They don't really need it because they already received a Nobel Prize, but we keep on giving this. We call that as a Matthew effect in science, right? So the same thing applies in research grants as well. You have one grant, you gained experience. Based on that, you produce a good output. This output also generates a lot more opportunities for you to generate a lot more research grants. And this is also important for career progression. As an academic, you tell your employer saying that, oh, I have got so much of money when the rest of the colleagues have not got it, or I brought so much of money to the institution. Your employer feels happy. Okay, it also is going to be useful for your promotion purposes. The last one is it feels good. Okay, whether you like it or not, when you have your money, your autonomy is there, you have research assistants working for you, it feels very, very nice because it gives you an enormous amount of space for exploring everything. Overall, it flows very well that it feels really good. You become a very confident person, right? These are the things for which we are looking at research grants. For example, if I'm very happy with my present job, I go there and do a couple of lectures and I'm getting my salary, or I'm having a small side business, I'm running it, I'm very happy. If you have this kind of approach to your work, you don't have to really worry about research grants. Okay, you can also sit back and relax and look at this talk as a time pass rather than looking at something serious. Okay, so this talk is basically meant for people who are really interested in progressing their career, who like to explore research, expanding horizons, okay, staying away from the control of your employer, and you want to feel good. You want to show that okay, you are working. You want to feel good about doing good, okay, in your work. If you are kind of relaxed and contented with what you are really doing, this talk may not be really relevant for you. All right. Any questions? Okay. When I ask if I have any questions, I will maybe give 5 seconds. 1, 2, 3, 4, 5.
Don't get it. Yes. Audible?
Yes, go ahead.
Am I audible? I'm David here.
Yes, David, I can please go ahead.
You were talking about breeds success. For a person who is just expecting a breakthrough, start something, what would be the chances of getting a research grant, or how? Hope I'm clear in my.
You need to repeat your question, David. I'm not able to hear you at all.
It was not audible, sir. The voice was breaking. Could you please type that in chat box?
Okay. No, you're talking about success breeds success. Is it model where, if you're already successful, this will work? Or is it, something that will equally work for a person who does not maybe have very good research, prior research experience, trying to get into this kind of things just at the beginning of such experiences? How does it work for a person like that?
Okay, a person who is not having a prior research grant. If I repeat your question, okay, if I do not have a prior research grant.
Yes.
I apply for a research grant, what are the chances that I will get it because I don't have a research grant? Right, and this is exactly a chicken and egg problem, right? So I assume that everybody has done a PhD. Okay, when you want to become a faculty member, you need to have a PhD, and you have produced some work out of your PhD. The publications out of your PhD is a good starting point. There are a lot of research grants available, which is for early researchers. What do you mean by early researchers? You just joined as an assistant professor in a department in an institute, and you don't have money. The research grants are basically meant for yearly researchers. So what happened is, I have a PhD, you have a PhD, both of us are applying for a research grant. Both of us are eligible to apply for a research grant. Now, where the formula for success breeds success will help only when you have publications. I have public, you have publications, and I do not have publications, you are likely to get the research grant. So to produce that PhD, okay, with some papers, okay, with some papers, you need to make a lot of extra efforts. Now, the question comes, how do I write research papers? How do I write research papers is not the scope of this particular talk. This talk is about writing research grants. So your thesis supervisor is able to help you in publishing some good work. Okay, so you come out of your PhD with at least three papers or two papers in a decent publication space. Then when you are applying for it, what happens? When you are applying for it, applying for a research grant for yearly researchers, all right? Now, those who are having a decent publication or a high quality publications are likely to get grants. You are signaling your capabilities by using these research grants. That's the first level. Now, if you ask me, if I don't have publications also, okay, out of my PhD, it's high time you stop bothering about research grants, try to write research papers out of your PhD. Okay, try to produce publications out of your PhD. That is very important. Then we will talk about research grants. All right. Hope I'm clear, David.
Sir, one more question has been posted in the
chat.
Shall I read it for you?
Okay, I can see the chat.
One Professor Amardeep Kurukwar had asked this question. How to plan to effectively use research grants? How to have vision and mission or outcome for that? Or will you be, or you may cover after talking about sources, agencies giving research grants?
The questions what he is asking, it will be covered as a part of the talk. Okay, next question is, good morning, sir. Today, most of the institutes accept the faculties to be multi-skilled, such as teaching, research, getting grants. How do you balance this out and identify the sources of the funding institutes? This also, I will cover it in my talk. Okay. So this too, I will cover it in the talk. Okay, I'll move forward. Right. Who gives money? Okay. You have now decided to raise research grants, and who gives money? One is the internal funding. Okay, your employer. Most of these institutions, okay, give a little bit of money when you join an institute. They call it the seed grant. In IITs, you give seed grant. I do not know about other places. But if your institute is going to say that, okay, when you come here, I will give you office space, I will give you a computer, I'll give you a laptop, I'll give you access to library resources, and you can also have a PhD student. Okay, that itself is also some form of funding, all right? Most of the Western universities, when you want to hire a PhD student, the institutes does not give you money. Okay, maybe in your life career, maybe two PhD scholarships are available to you as a faculty member. Otherwise, you need to generate your own money for your PhD students. Whereas in Indian institutions, what happens is the money is coming from the central government or the state government for the PhD program as a scholarship. So you get a PhD student for free. Okay, their salary is being paid by somebody else. That is also some kind of indirect funding. When you talk about funding, funding is not only about cash in the hand. It is also about different forms. So you can drive a research agenda through your PhD students also, whose fellowship somebody else is giving. That is some sort of internal funding. Sometimes your employer does not tell you exactly whether money is available or not. Okay. The first thing is you need to always ask your boss, always ask your dean saying that, is there a funding available? If I'm interested in doing this work, is there a funding available? Okay. When you're asking for it, you be very clear about, I'm looking for salary for two people for 1 year. I'm looking for this high computing systems. I'm looking for funding for this particular equipment X amount. Be specific and try to ask. You'll be surprised there are a lot more people, you will end up getting funding because there is some amount of money available for research and development in any universities, right? That's one. You periodically look at Government of India ministries, okay? I'm not talking about Department of Science and Technology. I'm talking about, say, for example, tribal development or youth development. there are multiple ministries are available. Okay, in the multiple ministries, they have some research grants available, money available with joint secretary to give away for research, right? Say for example, if you are in an engineering department, you are mechanical engineering department, you want to come up with some tools for agriculture, local farmers, not necessarily you need to get money from DST, you can also try with Ministry of Agriculture, right? Sometimes explicitly it is written that we are looking for call for proposals. Sometimes you write in a piece of paper, one pager called concept note. You clearly say that you are so and so, you are coming up this particular, you are doing this particular research. This is going to help so kind of people. This is the prototype or this is the idea. You write that and send it to the joint secretary directly saying that I'm looking at funds. You also give a little breakup of how much money you require. Okay. You will be surprised that a lot more people also come back with a reply saying that, oh, okay, I can look at this. Why don't you look at this particular avenues for getting the grants? Okay. Government of India ministries, look at their portals. And there are public research promoting organizations, say ICSSR for social sciences, humanities and social sciences, DST is for science and engineering, where they clearly call for proposals periodically. Looking at different disciplines, sometimes they ask for a multidisciplinary unit to come up and talk to you. Sometimes they clearly say that I'm looking at this only for this particular area, right? You need to do this, right? You focus or tweak your research a little bit to get money there. And there are international foundations and organizations. Names are four different IDRC, right? So say Water Foundation, there are multiple organizations that are available. Wherein you go and find out they're asking for research proposals from people from the developing world. Okay, we always make this argument, when I apply for DST, we don't get it. I'm coming from a smaller college, state university, which is not true. If your proposal is good, irrespective of the place where you are, you will end up getting money, right? International organizations don't care whether you're coming from a premier institute or from a smaller place. They just look at the quality of the proposals. You can compete with people. To give a simple example, when I joined IIT Delhi, I joined a department called Humanities and Social Sciences, and where there was no tradition of raising research grants. When I used to write proposals, people asked me, oh, do you have a Humanities and Social Sciences department in IITs? I thought only science and engineering is there in this department, in this institute. So I said, no, there is also another department. Okay, so people do not even know that you exist. Okay, but the quality of the proposal matters. There are foundations supported by corporate houses, say Premji Foundation, okay, or Asim Premji University for Education, Facebook. You look at call for proposals plus Facebook if you write. Okay, there are call for proposals being asked by Facebook. Facebook says that write a two-page proposal, I'll give you $75,000. IBM gives research grants related to electronic governance research. Okay, there are foundations supported by the corporate houses. Either it is part of the corporate houses clearly, or they just have the name, but money is available for you. Okay, and there are independent, not-for-profit research organizations. Okay, say for example, Center for Internet and Society. Okay, now they have received money from Asimji Foundation or from IDRC or from DST, but they are looking at a part of the work being done by researchers. Right, they say that we are looking for consultants. So you are working in a college, you go and work in a project for Center for Internet and Society, where the money is coming from, say, for example, Ford Foundation. Okay, for you, it's a research grant. Center for Internet and Society will give a part of the research grant to you, and you have a deliverable to give it to them. Okay, so you can also work there as well. Okay, you don't have to leave the organization, but it is being treated as a research grant for you. There are bilateral agreements between two countries, say Indo-Shastri between India and Canada. UKRI is between India and UK, right? Fulbright scholarships between India and US. So there are a lot of bilateral agreements between multiple countries. They periodically come up with call for research grants, okay, call for research proposals and fellowships and everything. So these are the set of people who gives you money. Okay. Any questions? Look at. Okay, I will just read the question.
Morning, sir.
Yes, Nilesh.
Yeah, good morning, sir. Generally, the projects or the grants are directly related to science or technology or ICT sector. So, is there any specific organization where we can approach for product, projects on social sciences and etc.?
I am from social sciences, Nilesh. I am a hardcore non-social, non-technology person, social sciences person. So, whatever examples I am giving is for social sciences.
Okay. Okay. Thank you. Thank you so much.
Right. Yeah. Amardeep takes agencies takes in a patent, copyright created out of the research by the funded agency. It depends. Okay. Some of the funding agencies says that, okay, this is a research I'm giving to you. You can publish papers, but we need to put my name also. Okay. Because I'm giving you money. Okay. Some of the agencies says that, okay, you can go for the patent, but one person from my company also being part of it. Now you can have an argument saying that why should I give you co-authorship? Why should I give you authorship and patent? But then you need to understand this, right? They have given money for a particular area. Okay, say for example, COVID condition has come. Now you are talking about a mask, a nice mask that controls everything. Okay, you are doing the research, but then this agency clearly said, I will give you money for COVID-related technologies. Okay, they have called for proposals and they have enabled your work. You wrote a proposal, I have reviewed your proposal and given you money. I'm participating in the entire process of doing something together. Okay, if you are very, very particular control about it, no, I will not share my findings with other people. I will not give co-authorship and everything. Then you are on your own. You raise your own, you get your own money and do it. Otherwise, it is impossible. Okay, 90% of the time, the funding agencies do not need collaboration. They just say that at the end of your research publication, you just acknowledge us. Okay, they give you a line saying that, this fund, this particular research was funded by X and B, okay, under this particular scheme. They want this acknowledgement to be written. That's all. I don't have to worry about anything. Right. Next question from Ariyan Ayagam. Is concept not applicable from self-financing engineering institutes? Yes. Okay. You don't have to worry whether you are from a self-financing institute or from the government. Concept note can be written by anyone. Only thing is, whether your college is having a proper accounting procedures. Suppose I'm a funding agency and I want to give you money, right? When I give you money at the end of the year, whether you'll be given, you'll be able to give an audited statement or not, okay? If you are able to give an audited statement, I will give you money. But if you are very, very dicey, okay? You don't want to give audited statement, okay? I will not make sure that the money goes to the faculty member. So those kind of engineering institutes will not get money. Okay, those kind of colleges will not get money. If your management is corrupt and unethical and do not have the professionalism, it's going to get very, very hard for you to get the money because funding agencies will understand very clearly. They will ask for last 2 years, give me your statements. Okay, they ask a lot more things. Even from IIT Delhi, we provide the audited statements to various funding agencies when they ask for it. So if your audited statements is not very clear, your college has been running by normal local business people, they are unprofessional, you will not get the money. You are in a wrong place. Okay, that's going to be very, very hard. Ashri Dhan is saying good morning. You can avoid good morning, good evening messages now. This is not a WhatsApp group. Okay, let us be very matured. Huh? Thank you. Right, I will go to the next one. Right. Okay, why do these people give money? One is altruism. Okay, genuinely they are interested in helping you out. Okay, so they keep a earmarked money saying that let us help me this researcher, so money is available. Or Bill Gates Foundation, Melinda Foundation thinks that okay, malaria has to be curbed or COVID vaccine rollout has to be done properly or not. They're genuinely interested in keeping this money. So any researchers who's interested in this particular domain or doing some work in the domain will get money from them, okay? Sometimes they do this to strengthen their agenda, okay? I have set an agenda in place, okay? I strongly believe that open democracy is very, very important. So I make all my efforts to bring this democracy open, okay? If anybody is working in this particular domain, okay, I will go ahead and fund their research. I will end up doing that. Okay. Sometimes the mandate of the organization, when they receive the money, say for example, if a ministry receives the money from the World Bank, when they give the 100 rupees, they say in 5 rupees of this particular 100 rupees should be spent on some research and development. It should be given, there should be an assessment, or there should be a development of technology. The fund should be given to an educational institution. There is a mandate. Whether they like it or not, they need to spend this money. Okay, they need to spend this money. So that money is also available. Sometimes you are looking at giving back, right? Some of the organizations gone from India, they made pots of money and they want to give it back to India. So this will come, okay, it's not a regular, it's not periodical. Sometimes the money is available, they want to give it to you and you want to do research. After that, they'll disappear. After that, they will go back to their normal lives. So that kind of funding is also available. Reciprocal agreements, Indian government gives money to some other country. The other country also says that, okay, I'll also give you money for this. Say, for example, UKRI, they say, when UK researchers come to India, we take care of them. When we go there, they take care of us. Okay, that kind of reciprocal agreements also being done. Okay, so these are multiple reasons for which they give money. Okay, now why I'm saying this is, okay, when you're applying for a research grant, you also need to understand what is funder's main motivation. Right, whether the way you are writing proposals and everything is aligned with the funder's motivation or not. So you need to understand this. Say, giving a small example, reciprocal agreement. UKRI wants, okay, UK researchers to come to India and India researchers go to UK. That's a deal, okay? But if you're going to catch hold of an Indian in UK, okay, as a part of your partner, okay, your proposal is weak because this entire program is basically meant for bringing UK people to India. So if you catch hold of a real UK citizen as a part of the proposal, your proposal gets stronger. So these kind of nuances, you need to understand this. It's a very, very simple logic, right? If you're running a grocery shop, if a customer walks in and looking for a washing powder, okay, you will not sell maida to this person, okay? But if one particular washing powder is not there, you try to push washing soap, you try to push some other brand of washing powder, right? You will not push maida, right? So should look in the same domain, aligned, so the other person also feels that you're talking something relevant, I'm willing to hear you, okay? Those kind of approach should be there, right? Okay. Any questions here? I'll move forward. Okay, where do you really find them? Okay, where do you find the funding agency? Where do you really find where the money is available or not? Okay, number one, very, very simple. Even if you're reading a research paper, you look at the acknowledgements more closely. Okay, every time when you're reading a research paper, look at the acknowledgements. Whether in the acknowledgements where they say that the money has come from a particular funding agency. If they have written the money is coming from the funding agency, you immediately go to the funding agency's website and see, is there a call open now? Okay, if it is not open, okay, take a note of it. You are going to periodically check this website whether money is going to be available or not. Lot of these websites, funding agencies clearly say that funding for this round is closed. The next round will open in, say, for example, March 2021. Okay, they clearly say this. So you take a note of it, you go back in 2021 and you look at this. You need to create Google alerts. Okay, you just look for call for research proposals. You just write call for research proposals in Google News, okay, or Google. You end up getting a lot of things. So you create a Google alert so that you keep on getting it in the email once in a week or something. So you will get to know what is really happening, right? You need to be a little bit smart and innovative to understand call for proposals in ABC. ABC in the sense, the particular area what you are really looking for. Otherwise, there will be a lot more information. You do not know where to use it. You subscribe to various newsletters of the agencies. The funding agencies also have newsletters. Okay, you go and subscribe to the newsletters. So you keep on periodically getting newsletters. So you don't have to go to their portal to get this. You can get it from the subscription directly. Employment news and other newspapers, you need to follow regularly. Okay, I stopped looking at employment news because I feel that I'm able to get adequate amount of information from the rest of the sources. Employment news is not that great. But anything related to bilateral agreement, research grants, other research grants coming from the government, Employment News is a great source. Other newspaper also, whichever is a leading newspaper. Okay, in Delhi, even we buy Times of India. I may not be happy with the quality of the newspapers, but then there's a leading newspaper, so you end up getting a lot of relevant news coming in the this leading newspapers. So you need to buy. Personal networks. You have friends. Okay, when you are doing PhD, you need to develop a lot of networks, right? You meet other PhD students from the other places, keep in touch with them, be good friends, try to write papers together. That kind of research network you need to build. So when you have a good research network built in place, if there is a call for proposal, and the call for proposal says that you need to have at least three people coming from three institutions to apply for a grant, your friend will remember you, they will come together to write a proposal. Okay. If you have been a very self-centric, egoistic person, if you have been a self-centric and egoistic person as a PhD student, okay, even if you have been bright, people don't want to work with you. Okay, you need to understand this, right? You can be a great person, nice person, but if you are an unbearable individual, right? I talk to you and you are very, very rude with me, and you try to show off that you are a great person, thinking that you are overconfident. Those kind of things don't work in a research environment, right? People would like to work with someone who is relatively easy to work with. Some friendliness is there, flexibility is there. You don't exploit me, I don't exploit me, we work together. So those kind of environments should be there. So when you have this network in place, whenever there is a call for a proposal, when they're looking for partners, they remember you. So you end up talking to people, you work together. So when you are also looking at proposals, and when there are partners are required, you write to people with whom you are in touch in your network. If you talk, write to strangers, people may not really agree to it. Okay, people may not really agree to strangers working together. It's very, very hard. Government websites, as I told you earlier, the ministry websites, you need to periodically check it. And you can also look at social media pages of potential donors. A lot of these people are having Facebook pages or Instagram pages or Twitter, especially Twitter and Facebook. You need to go and follow their pages, like their pages. And you spend time on it. So whenever there is a call for the proposal, so you get this information. Okay. These are the places you can find your funding agencies. Okay. Any questions?
Chat box.
Okay. Can you give a list of funding agents? Okay. And if you're going to ask me, say, for example, I can only teach you how to cook. Okay. I cannot supply all the items to your home. Okay. Now, this has been a major problem with Indian academics, right? What is stopping you to open Google and look for funding agencies, right? You spend a little bit of time on it to get it. So I'm sorry. I will not be able to give you a list of funding agencies. Okay, I don't have it. Whatever I have it, I have listed out in my slide. All right. Okay, I don't even know what area you are working on. It's going to be very hard for me. I'm sorry. Okay. Any other questions? Can we move forward? Yeah.
Yes.
Thank you. Now that you understood what is important, why raising funds are important, and you also know why do they give money, and we also know where do we really find them, right? Now, I'm trying to understand, okay, what are your necessary conditions? Okay. What basis you are going to get money? Okay, number one, good CV signals competencies. Okay, your CV needs to be good. Okay, what do you mean by CV needs to be good? Coming from a good place helps. Having a good publication helps. Last 5 years, if you are active, that helps. Active in the sense, I'm not saying that you need to have a great publications, but you need to say every year at least one conference paper you are writing, you are doing some activity. Okay, the minimum requirement is you are active. Okay, that is a minimum. The maximum can be anything. Okay, you have done a PhD from MIT or Stanford, you produce papers in top journals in the world, that's all on the top, right? Minimum requirement is you are staying active. You finish your PhD in 2017, when you are applying for a grant in 2020, last 3 years, are you active? Okay, are you writing papers, you have done something which is relevant to the proposal, the proposal area. That should be there in your CV. That signals the competencies. When I'm writing proposals, I should not get a feel that you are here for money. Okay, the funding agency should not think that, oh, you are just here for raising money and you are not really interested in this area. The passion, what you are excited about, should come out in the proposal. Now, what are the indicators? Your PhD is on this particular area, you have written something on this area, right? That means if I'm working in ICT for development, information and communication technologies for development, if I'm working in this particular area, I cannot apply for a research grant that is related to water resources management, right? Okay, water resource management, it is, they're giving money, but it's not relevant to my area. So I may not get the research. And they'll say that, why are you applying here? Your entire research and everything is completely different from this space. Why are you applying here? Okay, so there should be some kind of relevance that indicates about whether you are passionate. Okay, they also look at your research expertise. Okay, you say that I'm very good in handling big data. Now, how do I know as a funding agency that you are good with handling big data? Right, your paper publications. Okay, that's why even if you have written in a small conference, okay, there is some indication in your CV saying that you have expertise. That is very important. All right. You should have communicated your work in various conferences and meetings. Okay. So when you say that you have presented your work in a conference, okay, that is some level of peer review. That means you send a paper and people have looked at it and they found it okay, wouldn't you come and do the presentation? Okay, you have communicated. Okay, suppose you have communicated last 1 year, multiple places you have communicated. There is a possibility that when your proposal goes for a review, there is a possibility that the person who's reviewing the proposal has listened to you somewhere. Okay, have heard about your name, have heard about your presentation. Something will happen. Okay, for example, Dr. Elgin has been communicating with me for the last 3 days or 4 days, for example. Now I have this interaction, maybe after 1 year, okay, if I'm going to meet Elgin in a conference, we'll know each other. Say that, oh, I know you, how are you doing? Okay, the normal conversation will happen. You remember, what is the level of communication we had? Okay, he invited me, wouldn't he give a talk? I asked him, when do you need it? Normal email conversations, right? Same thing happens in a conference as well. Right, when your name gets printed in a conference brochure, okay, in the list of the papers, if the paper idea is very good, somebody would have noticed, say, let me attend this talk because the idea seems to be nice. They have attended this talk. Okay, so probably they came and spoke to you also after the talk. Right, when there is a call for proposals, okay, they remember you. Okay, they may end up writing to you saying that let us work together. Okay, or there is a possibility this person also become a panelist in reviewing the proposals. So they will also get to know about it. That's about the communication. So conference presentations and meetings. Okay, it is important that you stay active. The important one is, which is people do not understand this or underestimate, this is an institutional backup. Okay, accounting practices, space and incentive. Okay, if your institute says that, okay, do you need last 2 years balance sheet from my organization? I will give it to you. You want an audited statement for 2 years? I will give it to you. You want a cover letter supporting your proposal? I will give it to you. Okay. In the cover letter, it says that overhead charges should not be taken 20%, but you will take only 8%. I will give it to you. That is an institutional backup. Accounting practices, who are the auditors? Okay, it's very clearly given. Who are the auditors? That information should be given. As a part of the research, they say that I'm going to hire two people. The space has to be given by your institution. As a part of the cover letter, they certify clearly that if the money comes, I take responsibility for administering the research grant. I will give you the space. Okay, that thing is has to be very, very clear. The third one is incentive. Okay, what do you mean by incentive? Your institution should incentivize this research grants. Okay, suppose you raise money, say 10 lakhs, and your principal or director does not care about it. He said, what is the big deal? Okay, you are receiving 10 lakhs. If you, that kind of attitude is there, there's no point writing research grants. It's demotivating, okay? If you, they say that, okay, I recognize you, your director sends an email or a principal sends an email to everyone saying that I would like to congratulate ABC for receiving this 10 lakhs from this. That is a recognition. Even that minimum thing is required. If your institution is not backing you up for research grants, okay, sustaining research is very, very hard. You are in a wrong place, okay? And you should look for a different job or a different place, okay? But if I'm not having the adequate capacity to get a job in some other place, okay, then there is a problem. You don't have the capacity to get a job in some other place, and your institution is not supporting backup for your research grants, and there is a conflict situation. Okay, there is the relationship is going to be very, very stressful. You need to handle it. I don't have any solutions for it. Okay, unfortunately. Teamwork, co-working in projects, whether money has come or not, you continuously work with your colleagues. Okay, today I see a call for proposals. I cannot go and establish a relationship today. Okay, after looking at the call for proposals. You need to have a working relationship with someone going on all the time. Okay, money has not come, it is fine. Whatever resources we have, with using the resources, we continuously work. That excitement should be there. If that there is no excitement and you are not working together, what happens? When there is a call for proposals, the bonding doesn't happen. Okay, it's like one night stands. Things don't work, okay, the next day. To give a summary, okay, overall, you need to have some passion. And you build your expertise, you are continuously working and assuming that your institution is having a little bit of backup and you are working with someone all the time, okay? So you are not really looking for a research grant, but on at whatever level you are, you're working with your friend. Try to have friends, professional friends. I'm not saying that you go out with them for a drink every day, okay? Or talk bitch about your department colleagues or bitch about your institution. I'm not talking in that. Professional friends, we meet them in the corridor, you talk only research, go for a tea in the morning, talk only research. Little bit of bitching is okay, but predominantly the interactions are related to, okay, research and research corporate. If you do this, what will happen is ideas keep on originating, new ideas keep on coming, you continuously work. That is useful. All right. All right. Any questions?
So one question, sir.
Yes, please.
Sir, I'd like to ask whether the funding agencies differentiate between fundamental and applied research, sir, because we'd like to test a theory, because even in this COVID situation, many theories are coming about how to properly manage it. So if we want to test one particular theory, whether it's right or not, whether the funding agencies will provide us with funds for fundamental research or theory. Right.
Yeah. Answer is yes and no. Okay. Answer is yes and no. How? Money is available for fundamental research as well. Say, for example, if I'm a philosopher or a mathematician, okay, so I end up doing only fundamental research, or a theoretical physician. Okay, I end up doing only fundamental research. Money is available. But the amount of money available for application-oriented projects is any given day higher. Okay, it's more like a computer science faculty member will end up getting more money compared to philosophy professor, right? Or an English professor. So application oriented is relatively higher. Okay, so how do I handle this? I am interested in doing basic research, but money is available for application research. Okay, if you are excited about fundamental research, you write a proposal for application oriented, but you build questions related to fundamental questions, fundamental research. So if 100 rupees is coming, when you write in a proposal, In that, you write for two positions. I will hire two research associates. Okay. And you clearly justify that how it is aligned to your particular research, okay, a research proposal in place. When the money comes in, okay, one person is completely working on project, the actual project related things, you push them very hard, okay. Another one, you keep it for your own interest, okay. You are interested in looking at fundamental research, you tell this person, you hire accordingly, say that, okay, you are going to work on this particular thing. A research assistant does not need to know about what his actual project is. Okay, you assign a problem, they will end up doing this. Okay, so that can be done. Okay, say for example, whenever we receive a research grant, okay, the research grants are always adequate enough to explore your personal spaces. When I say personal spaces, your research area, what you are interested in. Parallelly, you can keep on doing it, no problem at all. But the funding agency, it is more like the funding agency says that I will give money only for masala dosa, okay? But you are interested in making basic dosas all the time. So you write a proposal for masala dosa and you hire two people. One person is taking masala dosa, another person is looking at basic dosas, okay? The basic dosa making can be a part of the proposal or can be hidden in the proposal, but you are working on it when the money comes. That is possible. Am I clear, Dr. Shyam?
Yes, sir. Thank you very much. Very clear, sir. Thank you.
Yeah. Okay. Amardeep's question, can I pursue, are there any management institute conducting online distance research fellow PhD during my teaching at institute? AICTE approved, good one, is there a possibility? Amardeep, this question is not relevant to what you are speaking. Okay. When you are raising question, try to understand whether it is relevant to this. We are talking about research grants. You are talking about where do I do online PhD? Okay. I don't think I can answer this question. I'm sorry. This is not the forum. Okay, any other questions?
Sir?
Is it not unethical? Of course, it's not unethical. Yeah. Dr. Bora's question, whether I will respond to this Dr. Bora's question, I'll take this question. Whether it is unethical? What is unethical? When I receive this money, I take this money and take my wife for a vacation to Goa. That is unethical, right? What is, when I say that in my proposal, I will say that I hire these people, I work on this particular research issue, I'm working on the research issue, right? Okay, what is unethical is I'm using it for my personal purposes. Anything related to related academic activity is not unethical. I don't have any issues with this. I can defend this anywhere, right? It is more like I'm working on a problem and I have a research associate is working on a problem. There is one more related issue, he's not able to do it. I will call my PhD student to solve this problem. Okay. So PhD student comes in and solving this problem. I will take a, just a minute, there's a flight crossing. Okay, a PhD student is also working on a project for a part-time basis. Then I will take money from the project as a honorarium and give it to the PhD student. Say 15,000 rupees, I'll give it to the PhD student. Now, you ask me whether it is unethical, I feel it is not. Okay, I am hiring this person on paper, clearly saying that what this person is working on is. Most of the funding agencies provide that flexibility. Okay, you can hire as long as it is academic. This is the job, which academic job, a job of a professor gives you that flexibility. Say for example, if you are calling someone to, calling a carpenter to construct a, say for example, chair, when you say four legs, okay, that is stringent, four legs you need to do. Whereas in academic world, we will say that I will come up with a chair, whether it can be three legs or six legs, that flexibility is there, okay? Your proposal provides a particular space. So it is okay. So Dr. Chandan Bora, your question, whether it is unethical, I don't think so. As long as it is academic, it is well within the project boundaries, you are working on it, no problem at all. Okay. Any questions?
Sorry, I have a doubt.
Yes, Dr. Kannan.
Yes, sir. Is there necessary, the HODs has to keep on the principal investigator in any funded project? Is it necessary?
No. Repeat your question.
Is it necessary to keep the department HOD should be the principal investigator in the funded project?
No, that is internal politics. That is unethical, right? It is unethical, right? When I write a proposal, my head of the department says, put me as the PI. Okay, what you need to do is, I do not know about the internal dynamics in your institute. If you say, no, I cannot do it, how much you will be harassed by your head of the department and the principal, I do not know. Okay. In IIT Delhi, I have adequate amount of autonomy to tell this person, sorry, I cannot do this. I can tell my director also saying that, I'm sorry, sir. I don't think I can do it because my director will change after 5 years. My head of the department will change after 2 years. I'm an independent person. I don't think you have that luxury in many places. Okay. It is almost, you need to handle this internal politics at your end. Okay. Internal politics at your end. Now, how are you handle your internal politics? It's completely up to you. Right. Now you put your head of the department in everything. Right. One of the ways of handling rude, unethical, exploitative head of the department is, you make them as a PI in a larger meeting, okay? You clearly say that in a larger meeting, saying that as a PI of this particular project, you will talk about the project. You stay quiet, okay? Expose this person very clearly, but indirectly expose this person. Are you faint? You are supposed to make a presentation as a part of your proposal, and you faint, saying that I'm not able to breathe. Then now, the PI of the project has to present it. And you look like a fool. Okay, there are lots of human beings who are not brought up nicely, who does not understand the fellow human beings, who are extremely rude and exploitative. But then this part of our culture, right? This is a feudal culture. So you need to look at ways and you need to handle it, deflect them, okay? But if you don't have the personality to handle this, you bear it. Okay, what is a big deal? As a PI, keep on putting and you keep on writing it. One fine day, okay, the truth will be out. Okay, your head of the department has been a PI in 3 or 4 projects, different kinds of projects. People easily read through the lines. He's saying that you are exploiting people. Okay, it may work in a short term, the long term doesn't really work. So it's up to you. Okay, Anil Raj, I don't say, I will not give an advice like take a gun and shoot this fellow. Okay, I will not do it because then I will go to jail by instigating you. But ideally, you should do that, right? Okay, Anil Raj, if the funding agency is constantly demanding for more and more new data on a regular basis, will it be wise to think for changing the funding agency? Anil Raj, Professor, if you have that luxury of multiple funding agencies in your hand and you are willing to give money, choice is yours. Please change it if you are not comfortable. Okay, if they're constantly demanding too much of data and everything, you want to change it, change it. But I was not having this luxury, right? I was having only 1 research grants or 2 research grants at the same time. I ended up delivering what these people are asking for all the time. If you have the luxury of changing the funding agency, you have multiple people are willing to give money, please go ahead. Probably you should give a talk, right? How do you really handle funding agencies? Okay, any other questions? Dr. Kannan, is it necessary? What is necessary?
Yes, sir, I have a question. Sir, is it necessary before I'm applying for the funding, I have to complete my project. The entire project I need to complete.
Before applying for a funding?
Yeah.
Then why do you need fund?
No, if I'm trying to fill up that form, they are asking some of the things. What is your focusing area? What are all the data? It's relevant to that. We need to fill up of all those information. So in that situation, I have a confusion whether I should complete before itself or after I want to do that. I have a little bit confusion with that.
I'm not sure whether I understood your question, Dr. Kannan. Okay. When you are writing a proposal, the work is not done. Okay. They say that what is the data you will be using? Then you propose. Okay. Your research grant, when you're writing, you are proposing what are the things you are going to do. Okay. Right, you need to demonstrate that you are familiar with this. Okay, say for example, when I will do a survey of 200 people, then that 200 people, what kind of people I'll be collecting data from? What is the kind of data I'll be collecting from? What is the data expected out of those people? That visualization should be there. That planning should be there. Okay, that's what the proposals look for.
Okay.
Right? So you need to write this one fruit proposal and defend it. One cycle, if you do it, you will understand this. Suhasini is saying, okay, I hope I'm clear, Dr. Kannan. Okay, Suhasini is saying pilot study. Okay, there is a possibility of it depends upon the field to field. Suppose if you're in engineering, you need a larger equipment even to do a pilot study, it is not possible. So you need to have a larger equipment. In social sciences, you demonstrate that you have done a little bit of work by doing pilot study. That is fine. Dr. Klothungan, good morning to all. This is too late, 1 hour. So we can avoid this kind of WhatsApp kind of messages. Let us be more matured. Okay, can I move forward? Okay, now, how do we get the funds? Okay, now that I'm very clear, my CV is okay, I'm quite active. Now I'm looking at how do I get the funds? I compete in the open call, okay? I don't care who's telling me what. I will look at a call for proposals. I write a research proposal and send it, okay? Lot of call for proposals do not even want to have a letter from your boss, okay? They say that you get the money, I will give the money directly to you, okay? You, if I say, for example, IBM Research says, I will give you $10,000 directly to you. I don't care. You can spend whatever way you want and you give me the report, okay? Facebook says that I will give the money only to your employer. IDRC will say that I'll give money only to your employer. Then I need a letter. Okay, what is more important? Compete in the open call. Don't worry about what people are giving advices. A lot of these advices are ill-advised, inexperienced, out of insecurity people give advices. Don't worry about these advices. If there is a call for proposal, you apply. You sit, write, and send the proposal. All right. Whether key people know your work, okay, if you are a middle level person, people should know that you are working in this area. Okay, if you are an entry level person, your research publications will indicate that what kind of work you are doing. So it is very important that whether the key people know. Whether the community should know you. What do you mean by community? I'm not talking about your caste or village. I'm talking about if you are working on ICT for development, your people should know, right? Say, for example, I went to IIT Roorkee for a guest talk, okay? And when the guest talk is over, people are asking me questions. Now, at least I know two students are working in ICT for development related work, okay? They are in the second year, third year work. I gone to IIT Roorkee. I given a guest talk. I know that these two people are working in this particular space. Right, now down the line, next 2 years, when they apply for a proposal, if I am the panelist to review it, when I look at it, if the IIT Roorkee is there, so I know that 2 years ago, I interacted with this person. So that level of work should be there. That means you've gone for conferences, you talk to people in this area, you return to them, those kind of things you need to do. You try to work with successful grantees. People have received an earlier research grant, okay, when you talk to them, right, you will know what it takes to get a research grant, what really happened. So your fake PI, your director or head of the department, principal, the guys who are exploiting people, they will have to understand this because they are useless people, they are parasites, right? The parasites will not understand what it takes, okay? But the people who have really done this work, identify them and ask them help, advice, okay? Ask them help in the sense, don't say that, give me a copy of a proposal, give me a list of funding agency, that is stupid. Okay, ask that, I'm writing this proposal, I'm facing this problem here. This is how I'm thinking on this. Okay, is it okay? Could you please give me feedback? Okay, could you please give me advice? Can I work with you? Okay, there's a call for proposals, can I sit with you, can I work with you? You put in efforts in writing the proposal, all right? You do that. Get feedback. There is nothing wrong in getting feedback from people. Okay. In my opinion, getting feedback is always useful. But the final decision is being taken by you, but you keep on taking feedback from people. Okay. Ideas cannot be stolen. Okay. A lot of us think that I have a grand idea. When I share my idea with people, they will steal it. I don't think that is really possible. Okay. In an idea at a very early level cannot be stolen at all. It takes great amount of efforts to do the implementation, right? So don't worry about that ideas will be stolen. Feel free to discuss with people, okay? Nothing wrong in it, right? When you go to a conference, you talk about an idea, proposal, you freely talk about it, try to understand it, okay? The 2 minutes conversation, 3 minutes conversations, people cannot steal ideas. The space is so huge. Money is available, so don't worry about this. You write proposal, it fails, no issues, rework and resubmit failed proposals. I have at least more than 20 different proposals which are failed and kept it in my folder. Some point of time, I'm going to go back and relook at this, some point of time. Continue publishing, whether really like it or not, you need to continuously publish, try to publish something, okay? Not necessarily a great quality publication, so keep on writing something. Your college says the only scopus indexed, I want 2 papers. Fine, you write 2 papers. If you have time, try to write in some other places also. That's for your own satisfaction to enhance your reach. Have a broad research umbrella, okay? Multiple areas you are working on, multiple ideas you are working on, but it comes in a broader area. It comes in a broader area. Okay. These are the ways by which you are moving towards getting the research grants. Okay. Any questions?
Sir, actually.
Please go ahead.
Yes, sir. Work with a successful grantee. Suppose I can write a letter to you, please accept me, sir, as a grant, that is assist to you. Should you accept me, sir, like that?
Say, for example, where are you working, Raghukannan?
Sir, I'm working in SRM Chennai.
Chennai, right. If a person coming from Virudhunagar, I'm from Virudhunagar.
Okay.
Right. A small college in Virudhunagar writes a letter to you saying that, can you accept me as a partner in a research project? What will you do? SRM is a relatively a university, and a person is coming from a smaller college writing to you. What will you say to the person?
Yes, sir. My institution policy is like that. Now I may accept it, that collaboration.
Okay. So what are things? So anyone you will accept it?
Not anyone, which is relevant to my research work, I can able to accept.
Find out the person is relevant to your research work.
So based on his proposal, idea, sharing with them, talk with them, discuss with them.
Same logic.
Okay.
Same logic. Okay. Now say for example, I want to build a roof for my bedroom in my house. Okay. I have 3-4 masons available. Okay. People who can come and build that wall. Right. Do I go for a person purely on the basis of whether I know this person, he's my relative, he's also a Tamilian, I know him for that reason? Or I'll go for a person whose work is good, that the wall is going to stay for a longer time?
The second option only.
Second option. So how do you demonstrate that?
Then I inquiring about him from various parties.
You send a CV.
I looked out his work. After I get the satisfaction.
The same logic applies here. So if Dr. Kannan is going to send an email to me, I will look at his CV. I will see what he has done. Okay. And his work and my work on the same area, and he has the capacity, definitely I will work. But if I feel that Dr. Kannan is a freeloader, okay, what do you mean freeloader? Don't want to do any work, but ride on somebody else's work. I will say, I'm sorry, I will get back to you, Dr. Kannan.
Okay.
That applies to me also. When I write to a professor in the University of Manchester, he will look at me whether I'm really a good person to work with or I'm a freeloader. Okay. If the other person feels that I'm a freeloader, right, like our directors and head of the departments and principals in many of these colleges, exploitative head of the departments, all right? If they are freeloaders, people say, I'm sorry. Freeloaders are easy to identify. Okay. The way you write, the way you speak, it's easy to identify. Okay, despite all these things, sometimes you end up taking a risk also. It's fine.
Okay. And moreover, sir.
Yes.
Another small requisition. it's my expectation you have to explain with this mode. So any example you have to take. So how you proceed of this funded project? How you converted that as a funded project? So if I get that methodology, na, it will be useful to me.
Okay, I will show you. Towards the end of the lecture, I will show you.
Thank you, sir.
Right. Pankaj, Dr. Pankaj saying, as a beginner, give some highlights, do's and don'ts in writing research proposal. I will cover it as I go along. Okay, any other question? All right, I will move on. Okay, types of research grants. Okay, one is the research grant is dependent on you are in. Okay, you are doing PhD, you are looking for a postdoc, you are an early stage researcher, you are a mid stage, or you are a senior researcher. Sometimes the research grants are also based on what stage you are in. They say that if you are a PhD student, ask for the grant, I will give you money. I'm looking for a postdoc, I will give you money. Research grants can be multiple. They also come in the form of fellowships. Okay, I will take off your salary. Okay, I will say that my research grant is in terms of only fellowship. Okay, I will give you your salary. You find a place like ICSSR has a postdoctoral fellowship. They'll give you 40,000 rupees or something. You write a proposal and send it to ICSSR. ICSSR say that who is your host? Okay, so you catch hold of a host in any university. That person says that I am happy to host this person. ICSSR gives money to this employer and the salary goes to the postdoc, right? It's very clear deal, right? Which stage you are in, that also helps. So you apply for a research grant that meets your research stages very, very clearly, okay? Next is focus. Whether the research grants are meant for salary or for equipment or for field work. Okay, some of the research grants say that I will not give money for equipments. I'm sorry, that's your institute's responsibility. Okay, some research grant says that I'll give only salary. Some institute says that some research grants will say that I'll give only for field work. Some of the grants will say that only for international meeting. You have your own money for salary, equipment, and field work, but if you want to meet your colleague in UK, I will give you money. Some of the research grants say that I'll give money only to the institutions. Okay, you want to build a program. If you want to run a master's program in cognitive sciences, I will give you money. Okay. Some of the grants will say that if you're a woman working in this particular region, I will give you money. Otherwise, I will not give you money. So you need to take a call on what is the type of the research grant they're asking for and apply for it. Right. Okay. Any questions relevant to this? Okay, I'll move forward. Yes. If there are no questions, I'll move forward. Yeah. Now the proposal. Okay. Stick to the call for proposals very closely. Okay. Whether you like it or not, very, very closely. What they ask, write only that. Okay. Very, very clearly. Okay. Don't change at all. Don't deviate. Whatever headings they give, you stick to the headings. Theme, they are asking for a proposal related to the theme very, very clearly, right? If they say 15th November by 10 o'clock, you need to submit, you submit, all right? If they say 5,000 words, 5,000 words. If they say that salary head this much, field work this much, miscellaneous this much, you should not exceed 10% of overhead, stick to it very, very rigidly. They say that you should have produced, okay, at least 5 papers. You should make sure that your CV is having that particular 5 paper. If they say that you need to give an audited statement of your employer, you need to provide it. Little bit of deviation here and there, okay, will get result in rejection. One of the best ideas is if the call for proposal says ABC, is just stick to ABC. Whether you like it or not, whether it is incomplete, whether it is not there, you just stick to it. Okay, they are the boss, they are asking for it, and you give it. Convention, Okay, objective, method, analysis, findings, and implications. Okay, conventional model. If you have done a PhD, this you are very familiar with. Okay, I would say each research proposal is almost like a PhD. Little bit of tweaking here and there it is required, otherwise it is more or less same. Copy edited if it is needed. One of the major problem with Indian researchers like us, okay, I studied in a Tamil medium, right? My English is not that great, right? So I write a proposal early days and catch hold of someone, help them, ask them to help me in terms of checking the English. How can I improve my language, right? Sometimes I end up writing long, long sentences. I tell them that, no. I'm not able to do this. How do I reduce the sentences? Look for things like Grammarly. Okay, there's an application that helps you in English. Word, verb. Okay, there's an application that improves your English. So we keep on, we go over BBC videos, how to improve your writing in English. Keep on working on this. This is very, very important, right? You may have great idea, but you do not know how do you really write it in a way that people are going to like it, that it's going to be problematic. So look at ways by which you can improve the English, right? I would say writing comes with experience, comes with a lot of failures. Okay, you keep on writing and over a period of time, you gain it. Okay, it doesn't come in a single day. Some of us are lucky, studied in a very good school, had great teachers. Some of us are not so lucky. Studied in a small school, Tamil medium. Teachers are hardworking, but they don't have the capacity. You learned it yourself over a period of time. Okay. Any questions here? No questions? People are going to sleep, right? Right. Oh, I'm so talented. I can make people to sleep in 60 minutes straight, right? Anyway, I'll follow this up. Points to ponder. Okay.
Right. No, sir. Everything is going well. Actually, the topic is so interesting, and the way you are telling us is so good. So thank we you, are really learning each and everything.
Thank you, Abdul. Right.
Right. Excellent, sir. We are all enjoying your talk, sir.
Thank you. Right. Now, points to ponder. Okay. Now, this comes to the interesting part. Proposal writing is time and energy consuming work. I want to write a proposal 1,500 words. It will roughly take 40 hours. Okay. Good proposal. The final one ready to submit will take 40 hours, 1,500 words, right? Now imagine 40 hours is the entire work week for you, okay? In a day, we work for 8 hours, 5 days a week, 40 hours. This proposal writing alone is going to take 40 hours. That means you are teaching, you are doing administration, you are handling office politics, okay? And you are trying to write a research paper, and you are also writing a proposal, all right? That means when you are talking about a deadline of November 31st, okay, you cannot start in 10 days. You cannot start in a week's time. You need to start much early, okay? Because you have a lot more things are coming up. If you have a small child, if you have an aging parent with you, they're also going to take a lot more time. So you decide how I'm going to manage this. That means, okay, you are sitting on your laptop all the time. Okay, whether you like it or not, you are sitting on your laptop all the time. There was a time my daughter tells me, okay, when people ask, okay, how's your father? Okay, my daughter tells me, my father, when I imagine is in a house, in a corner, where a little bit of light is there, he's kept the laptop and he's sitting on it, okay? Wherever you go and meet relatives, I'm carrying laptop because you never know. Okay, people are busy, getting busy everywhere. You sit in a corner, open your laptop and work. Antisocial. Because you're also teaching. You're also establishing yourself. Now, you decide whether it's really worth it. If you are a woman, okay, that means you're also talking about a lot more additional responsibilities. Like most of the Indian men are not so supporting in the whole front. Okay. So you are also right, wanting to write a research proposal is very hard. So you are managing everything put together and pulling out time for proposal. Okay. And proposal writing is a little bit of creative work. That means your mind should be a little bit free, right? Then you are longing for, if I get that 5 hours at a stretch, nobody bothers me, I'll be able to write. Unfortunately, you will never ever get that in your life. You join as an assistant professor in some place, teaching, yeah, semester begins, you do not know when the semester ends. Okay, administrative work, classes, students walking in, different kinds of things happen, all right? So that major chunk of time for 4 hours, 5 hours, you are longing for it, you will not get it. You need to find out within your schedule, when do I take out time, morning 30 minutes, and if everybody, every day I get up at 7 o'clock, I'm going to get up by 6 o'clock, okay, make a tea for myself, 45 minutes I'm going to have, I will work on the proposal for 45 minutes, okay, peace time, okay, reduce time, okay, reduce the activities that consume your time, okay, in a non-productive manner. Okay, you like to chat with your colleagues on useless things, you are enjoying it, but it is not productive, reduce it. Okay, after 5 years, that chat with your colleagues is not going to help you. Okay, only this will help. Okay, once you get one proposal done and you got the money, if you taste the blood and you will like it, and automatically you'll start focusing on this. But then the work-life balance, you need to take a call. What do you want to do with this? Okay, then some of my colleagues work extremely hard, okay, and no family time, all the time they're available for work. I'm okay in the sense I'm trying to balance this. My spouse always says that you are a workaholic. My colleagues say that you are doing okay. I feel that compared to a lot of my colleagues, I'm spending a lot of time in my home also. I'm enjoying my work also. So it's your call. Your inner peace is very important. You're working very hard. If at the end of the day, you are not happy, don't do it. Do what you are happy about. So it's very important. That is also important. Whether it is useful for your career progression. Your inner happiness is very, very good. Whether it is important for your career progression, whether your college or university appreciates this. If it doesn't appreciate it, it is purely for your personal satisfaction. If the personal satisfaction is not there, don't do it. And you also need to understand whether it's worth diverting to your new area of research. I am working on micro enterprises, use of mobile phones in micro enterprises. Now I'm moving on to sharing economy, say Uber and Ola. So you're moving from micro enterprises to sharing platforms. Is it worth moving? When you say worth moving, you're going to read enormous amount of literature, different ways of thinking, everything you are doing. It is really worth moving. Okay. Whether my institute provides adequate space for it. How? I was interested in social media research. Okay, but not much of research grants are available. Now, what do I do is, okay, I teach a course on social media. I'm doing a course on social media. I pull my students, PhD students to do research on social media. I teach a course. I direct my research, the PhD students into this space. Whenever there is a funding available, I try to keep on applying it. Okay, so far I'm not successful in social media research related stuff because not much of funding is available. Okay, it's not working out very well for me. But you need to decide, take a decision whether it is worth diverting to your new area of research. Okay, success rate, 1 in 7 for me. Okay, I write 7 proposals, I get money in only 1. 6 proposals go for a toss. Okay, now also I have 3 proposals under review. I may or may not get money. So every time, whenever there is a call for proposals, you keep on writing on it, okay? You may or may not get money, but you are writing on it. Okay. Any questions? Can you explain about budget head? Okay. I will go to the next slide and I will say, for example, I'm going to show a couple of proposals things. Let me see. So if you look at this, is an old one. It is saying impact evaluations of so and so in this. Okay, 2007. If you look at the deadline is clearly given. Let me see whether we wrote this, but we didn't get the money. Right, if you look at it, this is the one they're giving. Right, the headings, what they're asking is, can you see the slide? Can you see the PDF?
Yes, sir.
Right. So if you say that, it's saying that costs associated with site visits, field testing, engagement visits, workshops, and researcher time and travel, right? This is the only information they are giving. Okay, let me see whether they have. Okay, there's a budget form, right? Okay, budget form is not available in this. Okay. Okay, there is a template. Unfortunately, I do not have it here. So there's a broader headings that are being clearly given. Okay, I will also try to show your proposal. I'll just show the call for proposals first. Now, if you look at it, 2013-14, there's a call for research proposals. This is coming from, say, for example, IBM. Right, IBM Center for Business or Government is asking for it. Now let me see what is the money they give. Okay, these are the areas they want proposals: fostering innovation transformation, second, third, four, five, six topics they want this. Okay, now if you look at this is interesting part. Who is eligible? Anybody is working in universities, nonprofit, or journalism. Okay. How much they want a report? 10,000 words report they want. Okay. How much they're going to give? $20,000 for each report. Okay, which is a decent money, right? Which is a decent money for a report. Okay. Now when they look at the application, what they want is a proposal, 9,000 characters. Okay, 9,000 characters is not 9,000 words. Okay, it's around 2,000 words, right? They want this money, okay? And they want this proposal. In that proposal, you clear only this. Okay, they want only these details as a part of the proposal, okay? And not even for the budget breakup. They don't even want any budget breakup, right? Now, if you look at this, I tried 3 cycles and I did not get money in this. Okay, I'm trying very hard. Last 2 years, I got frustrated and left it, saying that there's no point trying it because, okay, somehow there is no match. In fact, I wrote to them also saying that every year I'm trying, you guys are rejecting me. Give me feedback and why it is not being done. Fine. All right, I will explain about the budget head, then I talk about the new research area. All right, okay, budget head, this is fine, all right? I will show you one more. If you look at it, this I received it in an email, then I clicked on the link it is given, right? Short-term research projects in social and digital media. Okay, 2016 they asked for it. These are the themes. We are interested in the following themes, right? Now, conditions, what are the conditions? And how much money they are giving? 1 lakh for a 1 year project, right? And they don't want even the budget heads. They don't even want the budget heads at all, right? Now I'll try to see whether I have any budget somewhere written. So what I have is very sensitive stuff. Now, give me a minute. Just a minute. So if you look at this, this is one of the proposals which we did not get money. So if you look at this budget head, okay, one is recurring, another one is non-recurring. And please understand that every call for proposals can have different kinds of heading. This is one of the headings. One is recurring, another one is non-recurring. You just list out what are the possible expenses that are likely to happen in your project. Just list out, write down completely. Then you break it. Manpower. Okay, how many people you are hiring per month, how much money you are paying. Okay, travel, you keep 1 lakh. Workshops, how much money you want. So you keep on writing all these things. If the funding agency says that give me a breakup, you should be able to give a breakup. You say that one person traveling from Delhi to Kerala for 3 days, okay, three times. One trip, 10,000 rupees flight ticket, per day, 4,000 rupees, 3 days, 12,000 rupees for the accommodation. 5,000 rupees for the travel, you put together, that breakup should be there. Okay. We are talking about different kinds of breakups. You put this and you write this particular figures here. Okay. This is an example for budget. Okay. Now I will. Okay. If you look at another budget, okay, this is under proposal. Okay. Research associate full time, you give a breakup and my screen is visible? Yes, no?
Yes, sir, it is visible.
Okay. So field work cost, online questionnaire, telecom database, this much, this is. Okay, overhead charges, 20% is this much. Okay, but the funding agency said we'll pay only 5 lakhs. They said, okay, 4,000 rupees will be borne by the project investigator. Okay, there's a spelling mistake. See, can you see? Through personal development funds at IIT Delhi. Okay, you see this. Okay, so okay, there is a spelling mistake. Ideally, you should not have that spelling mistake. Okay, so this is about examples. Now I'll see some more slides. Okay, how do you identify a new research area? Okay, there are no shortcuts in this. If you are constantly engaging in a particular research, new ideas will emerge automatically. Okay. If you are doing painting regularly, as you paint, new ideas will emerge. Okay. You need to dirty your hand, ideas will emerge. Right. When you are doing one particular research, when you are exploring this, okay, you end up identifying a new problem, you keep that separately for other ones. Okay. These are the multiple ways by which you can identify areas. In my area, okay, I use a couple of techniques. Number one, I keep on reading newspapers. If anybody is saying something interesting, I see whether it is, can be explored. Say, for example, sometime back, I read a news item where women in apartments, okay, cook extra food and sell it for money. Okay, we are talking about women who are not from poor class, middle class and above middle class. They are cooking food and selling it in their own among their own apartment people. Okay, I use a WhatsApp group. I say that I'm cook this food. Okay, for tomorrow's breakfast, you need to tell me beforehand. Or I say that I'm planning to cook chicken curry for tomorrow's lunch. If you want, let me know. Per plate is going to cost you 75 rupees. 2 pieces, 100 grams of chicken. Okay. So I sent this in my WhatsApp group. People say that I want 2 plates, 3 plates. They placed order previous evening. I cook and keep it ready. People come and pick that food directly from my apartment. I don't even go out of my apartment. Okay, this is called social commerce. So I looked at this. I found this very interesting. I said, oh, I can explore this as a research problem. Okay, then I will. So this is women, use of ICTs, social commerce, informal. So these are the ideas. That is, if there is a call for proposal related to women and technology, this is applicable. If there's a call for proposals to new business models, this is applicable. If there's a call for proposals in use of social media, this is applicable. So this is an idea that came from a newspaper article. This can be one. The second one is you look at leading research journals in your area. And every time there is a new issue comes up, you look at what they're working on. Okay, that also gives you a lot more ideas. For example, I was reading an article wherein how politicians use regional language tweets to reach their audience, voters, better. Okay, this is about how politicians use local language tweets to reach their audiences better. Now, I read this. This is social media analytics. This is very, very interesting and nice. Can I use that for marketing space? Okay, if a company uses regional language tweets, whether it can reach the customers better, that's a new idea. So you keep on thinking through this, talking to people, that is helpful. Okay, right, that's about how do you identify a new research area for Dr. Kannan. Shreya asking, from your extensive experience of proposal writing on a personal friend, what do you think are the reasons for proposal that are not accepted? Okay, number one, the competing proposals are very good. Okay, people who have written better proposals. I received 10 proposals, but I have money for only one proposal. The competing proposals are very good, number one. Number two, when your proposal gets rejected, sometimes you receive comments. That comments, you take them seriously. They say that methodology is not very clear. Your theoretical framework is not coming up very nicely. Okay, implications are not very clear. The reasons can be multiple. Okay, when your proposal gets accepted, right? And down the line, after 1 year, they end up publishing it. So when you look at their published work, you know that you lost a proposal in a competition to the other person has published, you look at the quality of the work, you will understand whether quality is better or not. Okay, how do you convert character limit into word limit? For example, 1,000 character limit is equivalent to word limit. This all simple Googling, you just Google for it, you will understand. Okay, there you don't really need to ask me this question. Say for example, when you click on it, that tells you this. Say for example, this is a Word document, click on the words. Okay, click on this words. The words are given, the characters are given here. Right, if I highlight this and click on this, says this. This is very simple. There are a lot of things can be done by just Googling. Right. Right. Any other questions?
Dear participants, now the forum is open for questions.
Yes. Feel free to ask me questions. Yeah. So if I know the answer, I'll say I'll give an answer. Otherwise, I'll say I don't know. Right. So as I promised you earlier, I will give a talk and I'll keep last 20 minutes, 30 minutes for Q&A. It's 20 minutes. So if you have any questions, it's fine.
Yes, sir. Yes, sir. Participants, if you would like to ask any questions, now you can directly ask the questions to the resource speaker.
Okay. Ganga Naidu is asking.
Shall I read through?
No, I can read this. To find out funding agents, can you do online? How do you find out? Yes, you can do online. Just open Google, say call for research proposals. You just write it. Okay. How to find out now? Yes, you open Google and write how to say call for research proposals. Okay, the active calls may not be available. Okay, I'm asking you. Ganga Naidu, switch on the video. I mean, switch on the audio and ask me. Can you do right now? Okay, I'll see.
Yeah, hello, sir. I am Abdul.
Yes, Abdul.
Yes, sir. See, without having an institute support, can we get the funding as an individual?
But then the money is being given to who?
To an individual to do the research work, because let me tell you, private management, what they are doing, they are exploiting already by not paying the right. Encourage the research fellow or.
Abdul, I'm not able to hear you.
I'm sorry. Okay.
Sir Abdul, can you hear me now? Your internet connection is not.
Hello, sir.
I can hear you, but it is breaking. Yeah. Okay, Rathi, is it possible to apply?
Can you hear me?
No. I repeat your question. Is it possible to apply without an affiliation to an institution? You want to get the money directly to an individual account? It is there. IBM, what I showed you, IBM does it, but then not many institutions give money like this. They give money to another institution. They give it to your employer. Okay. Sometimes what they do is they will give it to another registered nonprofit organization. Suppose you can start a nonprofit organization, you run it for a year, and you can apply through that research. But then they will ask for an audited statement of your NGO. So all these requirements should be in place, then you should be able to get the money. That gives you a lot more freedom. If a couple of management schools are exploiting, I understand that is unethical, that is very bad, but then we are not living in an ideal world. So you look for a better place to work. Okay, I understand it's very easy. I understand it's very easy to say, married, having kids, located to a particular place, it's not possible. But we need to give it, move on to a better place that takes care of the employees. Okay.
Thank you, sir. Thank you so much. And one more question I have for you. Is it okay, sir? Can I ask one more question?
Go ahead.
Can I collaborate with the foreign, the professors from California State?
Yes, you can.
State University or Yale University and UGC or NBS, DBT. Is it okay for?
Yes,
there can be a principal in the.
Yes.
Okay.
Done. No problem. Okay. There are a couple of more questions. Ganga Naidu is asking to find out funding agencies, can you do online? How to find out now? I'm asking you, can you do now? Right. I do not know. I will show you. I'll try to show. I hope you are aware of a thing called Google. Right. Now, call for research proposals. Okay, Dr. Naidu, which area do you work on? Right. Now, if you look at this, call for research proposal for development. You click on any one of them, right, for developing countries, international. Right. Now, if you look at this. Right, now say funding, IDRC I open for example. Okay. Right. Now this is available here. What else you want? Current opportunities, you open. What else do you need? Okay, now you go down. Okay, say for example, European grants for developing countries. You click on it. Now if there is a call, see the amount of calls available. Say support for entrepreneurship, micro enterprises, developing countries. You click on it. Right. Now this is Ethiopia. Now, okay, it is not relevant. Then you look for similar things. Okay. Now if you say that I'm located in Kerala, I work on water resources, show me where is a research grant available. I don't have an answer. Right. You need to search for it. In my area, I'm familiar. Not in everybody's area. Right. Okay, I will move on to the next question. From Balaji, when do you submit the proposal? Any time period is there? Of course, any proposal when they ask, they always talk about the time. Okay, 3 months in advance, they give call for proposals and they close it. Time period is always there. Dr. Jitesh, in your experience, which Indian agencies, if you know, issue grants easily, bit hassle-free, I haven't come across an agency that says that if your name is Jitesh, I'll give you money. That's the easiest possibility. But I don't think things don't work out. Okay, all the research agencies, there's a call for proposals, forms are hard, you write this up and submit it. Maybe you don't even get an acknowledgement. After 1 month, you receive an acknowledgement that keeps on going. Okay, hassle-free, I do not know how do you define it. Okay, life is not easy. There are no shortcuts.
Excuse me, sir. I have a question. It's regarding the project activities. Can we outsource some project activities? For example, is there any criteria like, you know, the share of project budget allocated to an external assistant should be this much and all? Is there any cutoff for that?
No problem, you can do it. In my work, I do a lot of data collection. The data collection happens with 5,000 people, 3,000 people using a questionnaire. So when I write the proposal, I clearly say that I'll be hiring an agency to do the data collection from 5,000 people. Per interview, I'm going to pay 500 rupees. That's the upper limit I have. So 5,000 into 500, I clearly list this out. Okay. When as a proposal, when I write this, when I send to the funding agency, when the money comes, the funding agency expects your educational institution, your employer to administer the grant. That means when you hire an agency, that agency will not get paid more than 500 rupees. Your employer will make sure that he's not going to get paid more than 500 rupees. Okay, so that is possible. The administration is done by your employer. All right. The agency likes certain institutions that follows that rigid rules. Okay, when the money also comes inside, okay, it's not that the field investigator, the project investigator is having all the freedom in spend the monies. No, whatever you have written in the proposal, say for example, in IIT Delhi, if I say I will pay 10,000 rupees to this marketing research company, okay, I cannot pay even 1 rupee more. IIT Delhi will not permit me to pay more. Okay, the money goes from IIT Delhi to the funding agency. I may give a letter, but the money goes. When the money goes, IIT Delhi will say, I can pay only for 10,000 rupees because that's what you have written in the proposal. That level of control is being done by the employer on behalf of the funding agency. So if a funding agency permits, no problem.
Okay. Sir, one more question from my side. Sir, can we include an ongoing activity in this project proposal? For example, suppose I have started one particular project and can I include these kind of factors? For example, a pilot study is conducted already. So can I consider that thing?
The call for proposal, some of the call for proposal encourages that. Okay, there is a call for proposal says that I will give you money for a project that is halfway and you didn't need money to finish it, I'll give you money. Some of the call for proposal says that you demonstrate that you have done preliminary work. So you can use this preliminary work as an evidence for ongoing progress of the work. That is permitted. You just look at the call for proposal, just look at what is being asked in the call for proposal, look at the form and accordingly you fill it. Okay. When a lot of time the call for proposal also gives a template, okay, what you are supposed to fill this up and you keep on filling this up. When you fill this up, in some space, they'll ask you whether the previous work is being done. If it is done, you write that. Otherwise, don't mention it. It is okay.
Thank you, sir.
Thank you.
I think if there are no further questions, then we shall
close it. Right. Thank you very much, Dr. Aljin. Madam, thank you very much for your.
Before closing, I must mention my deep sense of appreciation to Dr. Vignesh Ralarasan for enlightening us on why and how of research grants. The coverage was really very vast and excellent with details on about who gives it and how to find them. And also the details on proposal. I'm grateful to you for taking time out of this schedule and sharing your knowledge with us, sir. On behalf of Saint Louis College of Engineering and all participants present here, I wholeheartedly thank you for being here. Thank you.
So thank you very much. If you have any feedback, please let me know. Bye bye. Sure, wish you all the best. Get a lot of research grants and give me coffee whenever you meet me. Bye bye.
Yes, sir. Thank you. Thank you, sir.
Bye bye.
Participants.
The next session will begin by sharp 11:15. I request all the participants to join at least 5 minutes before the session commences.
Thank you, Professor. It's going wonderful. I must say, your team is doing a wonderful job.
Thank you, sir. Thank you.
And great to be a part of this thing. Thank you. Thank you so much.
Thank you, sir. Thank you. Thank you for your kind words.
Dr. Arora, are you available?
Yes, I am available.
Hi. Nice to hear from you. I am Dr. Roji, Dean of Sengis Institute of Management. Thanks for your nice comments. I'm happy to see that the program is going on very well.
Yes, Dr. Roji, I mean, it's really going wonderful, and I must appreciate the team of Sengis.
Credit goes to all participants also. Thanks for your active questions and interactions.
Yes.
That motivates us to have a good resource persons.
Definitely.
Thank you.
Thank you so much. It's always, I mean, as an academic fraternity, it's always a mutual support that we are there with. And I believe such activities definitely add value to the entire academia. And I think because in these specific scenarios of OBE gaining more, I would say the front seats, this becomes even more relevant. So thanks to you and your entire team. Professor Elgin is doing great job, and I'm sure as a institution, you have been doing a wonderful job in terms of adding value to the society as well.
Thank you, Dr. Arora.
Thank you, sir. Thank you.
We accept your comments, observations.
Thank you. Thank you so much.
We are going to start our second schedule, the second series. Request kindly give more publicity among your group members.
Sure, sir. Definitely.
Where are you from, Dr. Arora?
I am a director at Chandigarh University.
I see.
Director at the University School of Business here.
I see.
So out of the interest and out of my personal interest also, I mean, I was into it because I am very much fond of OBE.
Okay.
And we have been rated NAC A+.
Very good.
So that's we are also quite conscious about quality. So I was just to add value to myself also, I just thought of being a part of it. And this is something which definitely is a good thing. We all must keep on learning. So this is something which will definitely add value to all of us.
Did you receive NBA accreditation?
NBA?
Yes.
We are in the process, sir.
Oh, very good.
We're in the process. So that's it.
Okay. Thank you, Dr. Arora.
Right, sir. Thank you. Thank you so much.
Sir, excuse me.
Yes.
Sir, can we get the feedback link?
Yes, sir. I'm doing it, sir. I'm doing it. Just give me a second. I'm doing it.
Okay.
In a moment, sir.
Okay, ma'am.
Participants, the feedback link has been posted. Please be at 11:15 for the second session. Thank you.